Hari Om friends, welcome once again to my Sanatan Duniya channel, your spiritual home. In this video, I shall be giving my commentary upon verses 25 to 33 of the 4th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. For those of you who have not yet watched the commentaries on the previous verses of the Gita, I suggest you go ahead and watch these videos before proceeding further with this video. These videos are available in the playlist titled Bhagavad Gita Commentary, all 18 chapters. Before I go ahead and give the commentary upon these verses of the 4th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, I have a small request to make. If you have not already subscribed to my channel, then I suggest you do so, so that you may be updated about forthcoming videos uploaded to this channel. So let's move on. The 25th to 30th slokas of the 4th chapter of the Gita are as follows. Some yogis perfectly worship the demigods by offering different sacrifices to them, and some of them offer sacrifices in the fire of the Supreme Brahman. Some of them sacrifice the hearing process and the senses in the fire of the controlled mind, and others sacrifice the objects of the senses, such as sound, in the fire of sacrifice. Those who are interested in self-realization in terms of mind and sense control offer the functions of all the senses as well as the life force, breath, as oblations into the fire of the controlled mind. There are others who, enlightened by sacrificing their material possessions in severe austerities, take strict vows and practice the yoga of eightfold mysticism, and others study the Vedas for the advancement of transcendental knowledge. And there are even others who are inclined to the process of breath restraint to remain in trance, and they practice stopping the movement of the outgoing breath into the incoming and the incoming breath into the outgoing, and thus at last remain in trance, stopping all breathing. Some of them, curtailing the eating process, offer the outgoing breath into itself as a sacrifice. All these performers who know the meaning of sacrifice become cleansed of sinful reaction, and having tasted the nectar of the remnants of such sacrifice, they go to the supreme eternal atmosphere. The commentary of the mentioned six slokas is as follows. In these six verses, we find Bhagwan making a brief mention of the various types of yajnas or sacrifices offered by different people according to their inclinations and abilities. A yajna refers to a process or technique which is used as a sacrifice or offering or worship on the part of the person performing the yajna. The purpose of any yajna or formal worship is to purify the people who perform the yajna and help them achieve the desired material or spiritual rewards associated with the yajna. Yajnas may be performed to achieve a material objective or a spiritual objective. In these verses, we find a brief description and mention of the various types of yajna that can be performed. Yajnas can be done to satisfy any demigod who is in charge of a particular aspect of life and is therefore worshipped for the steady supply of necessities to the persons performing and attending the yajna. Hence we find Bhagwan saying that here that some people offer their worship to the demigods in charge of the various necessities of life. However, other people believe that demigods are only agents of the Supreme Lord or Paramatma, and hence they do not worship the demigods, as this is perceived by them to be an indirect or inferior way of worship of the ultimate God or Lord of creation. Hence, these people offer their worships directly to the Lord of creation or Supreme Brahman. Some yogis who have self-realization as their goal perform a type of yajna in which they offer their sense of hearing into the fire of sacrifice. Sense of hearing corresponds to sound, and sounds are almost always present in the space or ether, and hence yogis find it necessary to minimize their exposure to sounds during meditation. The lesser the sounds heard by the yogi in meditation, the more he will be able to focus on the silence of his soul, and hence Some yogis offer their sense of hearing as a sacrifice or offering to God. On the other hand, there are some yogis who offer sound and other objects of the senses as a sacrifice. Certain other yogis tend to offer all of their senses as a sacrifice along with the vital air of breath. Again, this too is done in order to steady the mind and gradually transcend the mind and attain the vision of the self. This way, these yogis too offer their senses and breath as offering and progress towards the goal of self-realization. There are other types of yogis who believe a lot in renunciation. Renunciation is indeed tough for the average person, but renunciation has a lot of benefits. When a person renounces his possessions and retires to the mountains to practice meditation in a peaceful environment, free from possessions and other distractions, then he generally tends to experience more peace. For example, a middle-class man might have much lesser wealth compared to a rich man, but a middle-class man tends to be more peaceful than a rich man, as a rich man is surrounded by a host of people in the form of friends and relatives who hover around the rich man's wealth like sharks wishing to eat some fish. Also, a rich man is worried about how to maintain and grow his wealth and how to enhance the performance of his investments and many other anxieties which come along with having many possessions. Hence, certain yogis believe that if they renounce their possessions, they shall be more peaceful. Even the great Lord Buddha renounced his possessions in order to find peace and pave the way for his own self-realization. Apart from these, there are other yogis who emphasize the study of the scriptures and try to make advancement on the spiritual path through the path of Jnana Yoga. They first study the scriptures under a qualified guru and then contemplate on the meaning of the truths revealed in the scriptures and thereby purify their minds and march onwards towards the goal of self-realization. Now the next type of sacrifice being mentioned by Bhagwan is called pranayama. Prana means breath and ayama means restraint. Therefore, these yogis who practice pranayama practice breathing in a particular way which opens their chakras, clears their nadis or astral tubes and awakens their kundalini which helps them attain self-realization. They tend to do deep rhythmic breathing in which they breathe in and out in a specific way. I have myself learned quite a few types of pranayama from a couple of gurus, but as per their strict rules, I am not supposed to be teaching these techniques to anyone without becoming a qualified teacher under their fold. What I have mentioned above is just an idea so that you can understand what I mean by pranayama. If you wish to learn in detail about these pranayamas, then I suggest you contact a spiritual organization which teaches these techniques and learn these breathing techniques from a qualified teacher or guru. Please do not practice these techniques on your own based on your imagination or by reading in a book or watching a YouTube video. These techniques have to be learned and practiced under a guru's guidance. Finally, Bhagwan is mentioning another type of sacrifice or offering involving food and dietary regulations. Some people fast on specific auspicious days such as Ekadashi and other auspicious days. This fasting brings more strength and independence to the body. It also gives a much needed rest to the stomach and to the digestive system, and other bodily functions are also regulated by fasting. One can opt for a fruit diet on specific days, which helps a lot in clearing toxins from the body and also purifying the body and mind. After all, we are what we eat. So Bhagwan, after briefly describing the different types of yajnas in these verses, is saying that all these people who practice these yajnas get cleansed of sinful reaction and become peaceful and happy in their lives. They also, in accordance with their degree of advancement, manage to attain the eternal abode of the Lord God. Now I shall move on to verses 31 to 33. The 31st to 33rd verses of the 4th chapter of the Gita are as follows. O best of the Kuru dynasty, without sacrifice one can never live happily on this planet or in this life. What then of the next? All these different types of sacrifice are approved by the Vedas, and all of them are born of different types of work. Knowing them as such, you will become liberated. O chastiser of the enemy, the sacrifice of knowledge is greater than the sacrifice of material possessions. O son of Pritha, after all, the sacrifice of work culminates in transcendental knowledge. The commentary of the mentioned three slokas is as follows. We saw in the previous six verses that Bhagwan had mentioned the different types of sacrifice and the benefit of practicing these sacrifices, such as purity, cleansing of sinful reactions, happiness, and residence in the Lord God's abode. Here in the next verse, Bhagwan is once again emphasizing the importance of performing sacrifices. He says that without performing some or other of the above sacrifices, there is no possibility of being happy here in this world. And if one cannot be happy in this world, then one's disturbed state of mind will continue even after death, when the soul leaves the body and takes the subtle body along with it. This unhappiness continues to remain in the subtle body even after the death of the physical body, and hence one cannot be happy even in the next realm of existence of the soul, even if it be heaven or any other pleasant realm of existence. Bhagwan is further saying that since these different types of yajnas are born out of activity, and since they are mentioned in the authoritative Vedas which have emerged from the Lord's own mouth, these yajnas are therefore approved and reliable means of cleansing one of sinful reactions. Thus Lord Krishna is assuring here that by practicing any of these yajnas over a long period of time, one shall attain liberation. Bhagwan is adding another point about the performance of sacrifice in the next verse. He says that the sacrifices involving the spread and dissemination of spiritual knowledge are superior to sacrifices involving only the sacrifice of material possessions. There is a reason for this. By sacrificing material possessions, one may become a little purer and cleansed of impurities, but this sacrifice by itself does not lead to the gain of knowledge. However, the sacrifice involving the dissemination of knowledge gives both the knowledge and the consequent detachment from material possessions. Since the sacrifice of knowledge provides both of these results, these sacrifices are considered to be superior to the sacrifice of the material possessions. So friends, here ends the commentary on the 25th to 33rd verses of the 4th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Stay tuned for more commentaries on the following verses of the Gita, and keep checking this channel for updates to this playlist titled Bhagavad Gita Commentary All 18 Chapters. And also do watch the other videos available in this channel so that you can enhance your knowledge of the eternal religion or Sanatan Dharma. And in case you have not already subscribed to my channel, then I suggest you do so, so that you may be updated about forthcoming videos uploaded to this channel. Thank you very much for watching. Have a great time ahead. Hari Om.